by Professor Madhu Khanna ji, Sacred Geometry of the Sri Chakra of the Cult of Goddess Tripura Sundari. So, Ganapati ji.
Kalaja Tasmai Namaha. Learned friends, it's indeed a privilege to be amongst you and discussing various abstract as well as down-to-earth elements of our life. On this day, we are going to speak about few things that we are associated with. And we had very scholarly presentations in the morning, which dealt with the theoretical physics part and the mathematical part of it. In this presentation, I would talk more about the humanistic relationship between those diagrams and their remembrances in our daily lives and how they are pertinent. As advised by the chair, I would give a little introduction of myself. I am Dr. Vamshi Krishna Ghanapaathi, a disciple of Shri Ganapati Sachidananda Swamiji, our Guruji. We had the good fortune of studying Yajurveda, Rigveda, and Samaveda, and Atharvaveda. And we are in the process of publishing the digital versions of all the Vedic texts along with their all the nuances. And we are making a specialized repository and search engine for Vedic texts and along with the commentaries and Padabhagas. And this would be followed by the Vaidika Padakosha project, digitized version. Now, okay, I will start with the first verse in the Savitra Agni Chayana. The Savitra Agni is a very special concept which is espoused in the Krishna Yajurveda. Actually, it's a series of short stories. Some of the stories do not extend beyond four sentences. Why it is important means the knowledge is compared to mountains, but the time which is bestowed in this life is very limited. And how do you capture the essence of that knowledge? That is the crux of the entire story of Savitra Agni. To put it in a better narrative, the legend of Sage Bharadwaja is given. Sage Bharadwaja grew very old, and an old Brahmin, actually Indra was that Brahmin, he came and asked Bharadwaja, "You have become very old. What else do you wish to do in this life?" He said, "I had sought extensions, three extensions of my life, and I had done enormous study of Veda. Veda is nothing but Jnana." Then Indra had led that Bharadwaja Rishi to his mountains. There are three mountains, and he took three fistfuls of earth and he showed. So this is what you have obtained in your three lives, and the rest of them is, it is compared to those mountains. So it is not actually possible to capture everything in the minutest detail in our lifetime, but it is very important to take the essence of it. How best can you do that? Then he has given the Savitra Agni Vidya. Esho eva trayi vidya. Iti Vedas trayas trayi. Rik yajus sama ar trayi. Atharva is actually a partly, mostly rik and partly yajus. So it's only the three types of mantras are called the trayi. So in this essence, I am giving you the Upadesha of Savitra Agni, using which you would be able to capture the essence and gist of your entire knowledge and wisdom. That is the speciality of the Savitra Agni. Then, how best can you capture the essence of Savitra Agni? Then again, there are a series of conversations between two disciples and one Acharya. One of them is as simple as this. When there was a thought process which was ignited in the deities, many of us are perishing, and many of us are prone to many negative thoughts and negative deeds. How best can we rein in ourselves? What is the best possibility? And we all conduct many yajnas, many karmas, and how best do we control ourselves? That was the topic of it. This is the preamble of the Savitra Agni. They say, Vidyut and Vrishti. Vidyut is actually literally translated as electricity or probably lightning. And Vrishti is the rains. But it has a different yogika artha. The etymologically, it is explained in a different way. Dhyati, do avakhandane. Dhyati means to amputate. O vrishchu khandane. Vrishchu also means to amputate. So what exactly is getting amputated is the tendency to commit more sins. The negativity has to be separated. This is also in the preamble of Savitra Agni. Why it is given? They say, dissect the time. What is exactly the time? It is very beautifully narrated. In the executive summary, I have just given this. Since time immemorial, humans are fascinated by the patterns of the nature and gradually assimilated their lives on those patterns. These extensions of assimilations expanded from the mundane affairs to their perception of the divinity. Therefore, our current societal practices and movements are governed by this doctrine of beliefs and philosophy. Accordingly, subtle and gross elements of the nature are linked with various shapes and forms in every civilization. And in this article, we will examine the Savitra Agni Chagana ritual, and in the latter part we will also look at the Agnihotra, the daily ritual of Yajnashala, Agni Vihara, and the Shrauta Karmas, and various shapes of Homa Kundas as enunciated in Kundarka, a treatise on the construction and dimensions of fire pits of 10 types. Kalaja Tasmai Namaha, Kale Manaha, Kale Nama Samahitam, Kaloha Sarvasyeshvaraha, Yah Pitasit Prajapatehe, Teneshitam, Tena Jatam, Tadu Tasmin Pratishthitam, Kaloha Brahma Bhutva, Bibharti Parameshthinam. This mantra from Atharvaveda says that Kala is everything which also brings out the concept of divinity and the almighty. Kaloha Brahma Bhutva, Bibharti Parameshthinam. It upholds the principle of Parameshthi. Now, what is time exactly? Time is a method of measurement to gauge the movement of an object. Celestial objects such as the stars and the planets are notably the subjects of this measurement for calendar year as well as the division of the day and night. And the Nakshatreshti of Krishna Yajurveda gives the most elaborate description of the clusters of stars. It is not exactly the stars, the one star. It's a cluster of star. For example, if I say Mula, it is only one. When I say Ashadha, Yajurveda says Ashadha, it's a group of cluster. When I say Punarvasu, Punarvasu is a duo. It's a pair of stars. So these are some of the observations. And some of the inferences are even more beautiful. What exactly, how did stars form at first place? They say, Sukrutamva etani jyoti gumshi yan nakshatrani, those with meritorious deeds, with the heightened consciousness, they have become one in the Almighty, and they have become part of the divinity, and that is a manifestation of the divinity, that is the star. Sukrutam va etani jyotigumshi. And we had several timekeeping mechanisms, and which are actually formed with painstaking and diligent observations spanning many millennia. In our nakshatreshti and chaturmasya rituals, the rituals themselves were devised to sensitize and educate the community about natural occurrences. And Savitra Agni Chayana is also one among those efforts. Actually, it is called the Kshudra Chayana. Chayana is an elaborate ritual in which the altar is made of special clay bricks. And in this Kshudra Chayana, only small particles are taken and they represent the cosmos. The Savitra Agni Chayana, I will just explain the procedure of it briefly. The ritual of Savitra Agni Chayana is performed in the northern section of Soma Yagashala. It is in the Soma Yagashala. It's called the Uttara Vedi. On the previous day, the Agna Vaishnava Ishti is performed. Agna Vaishnava Ishti is another, it's a speciality. In the Vedic legends, Agni Avamaha Devatanam Vishnu Paramaha. Vishnu is the paramount and Agni is the lowest among the deities in the hierarchy. So, if you need to bring something, you will assign to the lowest among your group. And the topmost is never touched. So, this is the paramountcy given to the hierarchy. And after this, a bundle of special green grass, it is called the Harita Darbhastamba, is placed in the designated circular altar at the ground level, and 10 circles are drawn around. In each section, few pebbles or small particles, small stone particles are placed, invoking each preceding deity for each unit of time. I will detail it in the later part. This is called the Upadhana. Upadhana is to just place it, placement. In the central dot, Prajapati as the creator is invoked in the form of the presiding deity. He is called Prajapatihi Samvatsaraha Mahan Kaha. And then Sikata, the sand particles are strewn around to cover the areas and the periphery of each circle, and these represent the listless celestial objects such as the stardust, comets and asteroids. And later the sacrificial fire is brought for the lateral Homa procedures. Now, this is the Somayaga altar. This is called the Mahavedi. This is called the Mahavedi, and this is the Havirdhana Mandap, this is the Agnidhra Mandapa, and these are the, this is the regular Yajnashala of the Yajamana. This is called the Sado Mandapa. And to the north of this, we perform the Savitra Agni Chayana. This is the actual scene of Savitra Agni Chayana, and you can see here the 10 circles which are placed here, and all these are the pebbles or the stones which are representing various units of time. And this starts with the deities of 15 days in a Shukla Paksha, the bright fortnight. Each day is approximately 20 hours or 30 ghatikas or 720 vighatikas. Each month has two fortnights, we all know that. A name is given to each day in fortnight. Samjnanam, Vijnanam, Prajnanam, Janata, Abhijanata, Sankalpamanam, Prakalpamanam, Upakalpamanam, Upakluptam, Kluptam, Shreyaha, Vasijaha, Ajat, Sambhutam, Bhutam. With these four lines, for every day we have a specific name. And then again, deities for each of the 15 muhurtas during a day. Each day is divided into 15 muhurta kalas. That means 12 hours is divided into 15 parts. The equinox day or the Vishvapat Punyakala is taken as the base unit for easier calculation without minute fractions or decimal counts. Muhurta is divided into 15 parts and each part is called as the with a duration of 48 minutes or 2 vighatikas. And Chitra, Ketu, Prabhan, Abhan, Sambhan, Jyotishman, Tejasvan, Atapan, Tapan, Abhitapan, Rochanaha, Rochamanaha, Shobhanaha, Shobhamanaha, Kalyanaha. Each month has two fortnights, we all know that. And now the names of the nights in Shukla Paksha are also given here. Darisha, Drushta, Darishata, Vishwarupa, Sudarshana, Apyajamana, Pyajamana, Pyaja, Sunruta, Ira. Apuryamana, Puryamana, Purayanti, Purna, Purnamasi. And again, the muhurtas for the night time, the 15, that means 48 minutes of one muhurta duration, and they are given 15 for the entire night. Data, Pradata, Anandaha, Modaha, Pramodaha, Aveshagan, Niveshagan, Samveshana, Samshanta, Shanta, Abhavan, Prabhavan, Sambhavan, Sambhutaha, Bhutaha. And again, we come to the Krishna Paksha daytime deities. Prastutam, Vishtutam, Samustutam, Kalyanam, Vishwarupam, Shukram, Amrutam, Tejasvi, Tejaha, Samiddham, Arunam, Bhanumat, Marichimat, Abhitapat, Tapasvat. And again, the muhurtas for the daytime in the Krishna Paksha. Savita, Prasavita, Deeptaha, Deepajan, Deepyamanaha, Jvalan, Jvalita, Tapan, Vitapan, Santapan, Rochanaha, Rochamanaha, Shumbhuhu, Shumbhamanaha, Vamaha. Then again the Krishna Paksha nighttime deities. Suta, Sunvati, Prasuta, Suyamana, Abhishuyamana, Piti, Prapa, Sampa, Truptihi, Tarpayanti, Kanta, Kamya, Kamajata, Ajushmati, Kamadugha. And again, Krishna Paksha, night time, Muhurtas, 15 again. Abhishasta, Anumanta, Anandaha, Modaha, Pramodaha, Asadagan, Nishadagan, Samsadanaha, Samsannaha, Sannaha, Abhuhu, Vibhuhu, Prabhuhu, Shambhuhu, Bhuvaha. And again, the 12 Shukla Pakshas have a specific name of each deity. Pavitram, Pavagishyan, Putaha, Medhyaha, Yashaha, Yashasvan, Ayuhu, Amrutaha, Jeevaha, Jeevishyan, Svargaha, Lokaha. And again, the Krishna Paksha has a specific name. Sahasvan, Sahiyan, Ojasvan, Sahamanaha, Jayan, Abhijayan, Sudravinaha, Dravinodaha, Ardra Pavitraha, Harikeshaha, Modaha, Pramodaha. And again we have the names for the 12 months. As we all know, in our lunisonar system, we exactly do not follow the Chandramana. It's a Chandra Sauramana. We always compare and reconcile the Sauramana with the Chandramana. So to make it uniform, we add one month where the Surya Sankramana does not happen. When it does not happen, it becomes a Adhika Masa. Occasionally, when two Sankramanas happen in the same month, it is called the Kshaya Masa. That is the lunisolar system. And here 12 plus 1, that is the 13 months. This is a sort of leap year. We have Arunaha, Arunarajaha, Pundarikaha, Vishwajit, Abhijit, Ardraha, Pinvamanaha, Annavan, Rasavan, Iravan, Sarvaushadaha, Sambharaha, Mahasvan. And then we have the Sikatas. I have referred to the multiple particles that are strewn around. Ejatkaha, Jovatkaha, Kshullakaha, Shipivishtaha, Shipivishtakaha, Sarisraraha, Susheravaha, Ajirasaha, Gamishnavaha. And then intermittent calculations and casual relative references, such as now, then. idanim tadanim etarihi kshipram ajiram ashuhu nimeshaha phanaha dravan atidravan tvaran tvaramanaha ashuhu ashiyan javaha. Then we have got the six primary rituals. They are called the agnishtoma, ukthya, atiratra, dviratra, triratra, chaturatra. These correspond to the six seasons, six ritus, shad ritus of the year. And again, agni rituhu, surya rituhu, chandrama rituhu. Agni is the fire, surya is sun, and chandrama is the moon. These refer to the three general seasons, such as the summer, rain, and winter seasons. And finally, prajapati, samvatsaraha, mahan, kaha. And around that we have the four sides, four dik, agni, vayu, aditya, and chandra. These are the bricks, these are placed. And finally, the prayer after this, after the arrangement is done, tvameva tvam vetha, samvatsarosi, parivatsarosi. Who knows best about you? The Vedic verses say that you know the best about you. No one else knows. Someone might pretend that he knows about you, but only you know perfectly about you. And this is being addressed to the God. And they say, when you know the perfect, you know the complete, you have the complete picture about yourself, you best impart that to us, so that we know ourselves better. And then what is the purpose of having, invoking all these deities? They say, the primary concept was to make you sinless and blemishless and spotless. For to commit any sin, you need two things. What do you need? A space, a place to make a sin, commit a sin. And the second one, you need time. If you don't have time, because all the sins, organized crime and unorganized crime, they all happen only when people have most, they have most time. The busy people actually don't have much time to think about nefarious things. So, you need time to commit any sin. When you are imbibed, when you are brainwashed, that a particular time is governed by a deity who is having a watchful eye on you, then you don't have the time to commit any sin. So, the idea is to inculcate the idea that every deity at the particular time, at any given point of time, is watching you. So this is being taught to the children so that they become spotless and blemishless and sinless. That is the concept of Savitra Agni Chagina. And all these stories, they just point out to these things. And they give us three names. Gruni, Surya, Aditya. Those who master the concepts of these three names, they will get ample wealth. That is the literal meaning of the sentence. How is it possible just by knowing the meanings? Now we are in the solar system and solar energy. We know too many things about it. Ghr Kshara Deeptav. Ghruni means one who is resplendent and who is always shining. And Surya is the one who gives us good speech. Sushtu Iragatiti Surya. That is the etymological meaning in the Nirukta. Sushtu Iragati Iti Suryaha. So, once you are in the bright sunshine, your ideas are also getting brightened and your speech is also become refined. And Surya is the one who is actually influencing your thought process. That is the meaning of Gayatri Mantra also. Gayatri Mantra means, may that Almighty influence and guide and prompt my mind to think positively and to speak positively. And the last one is not the least. That is Aditya. Aditya means one who is not annihilated, who is not destroyed. So by the virtue of good health and good speech and good thoughts, you will become Ananta and you will not have any harm. So you will lead a harmless life. That is the concept of Savitra Agni Chagina in brief. And now we go to the... How much time we have left?
8 minutes.
Okay, that's good. Sorry. Now we are going to the Agnihotra Shara. In the morning we had our good friend who has demonstrated about the Agnihotra Shala. In Shrauta rituals, the square-shaped Homakunda in the eastern section is the most important pit, where the main oblations are offered. It is the quadrangle-shaped, likened to the heaven. Although specific references are not available to denote the significance of each shape, it is believed that the shape is governed by the Purushartha philosophy. It is pertinent to make a note that the shapes which are governed in the Vedic verses, they do not suggest a particular reason, a particular cause, why they are giving out this particular shape. They have not detailed about it. And none of the commentators have made any authentic and authoritative information about it. So it is left to the inferences and speculations. But most of them are pragmatic. And one about this quadrangle shaped Ahavaniya is that. So this is that. The quadrangle shaped Ahavaniya, which you can say this. This is called the Vedi. And this is the Dakshinagni. This is the Garhapatya. Garhapatya is round in shape. And Dakshinagni is semicircular, and Ahavaniya is square and Vedi. And this is called the Amsa. Amsa is the shoulder, and the Ahavaniya is said to be the head. And this is called the Shroni or the knees. It is similar to a person who is kneeling, who is actually folded his legs, and who is actually lying down with his head to the east. That is the reason why all the Pradhana Ahutis are given here in the Ahavaniya Kunda. And the Dakshinagni is predominantly maintained for the pleasure of ancestors. And how is that achieved? By feeding. So the main food is cooked here, and that is served to the participants here. And the mantras also say, Atharva pitumme gopaya rasamanna mihajushe adabdhayo ashitatano avishannaha pitum krunu. Please make our food free of poison, because most of our toxins enter our body through the food. So it has to be toxin free. That is the purpose of the mantra. And it also gives us one very good suggestion. Adabdhayo ashitatano. The food which is heated and sterilized, it would be toxin free. That is one important suggestion given here. And the Ahavaniya, as I said, it is governed by the Purusharthas, the Brahmacharya, that is the education part of the life, Grihastha, the householder life of earning and supporting the society, and the Vanaprastha, retreat from the worldly affairs, and finally the Sannyasa, total renunciation. So the Ahavaniya shape of quadrangle is driven by this philosophy. And the Dakshinagni philosophy, it has, see, we all know that each month has two parts, and if the moon is in round shape, if it is sliced into two, it becomes two fortnights. So each fortnight a ishti is performed and the food is served. That means in this way the fortnightly ritual related cooking and feeding suggests the connection between the with the shape. Associated also, mantras also signify the same. And the Garhapatya is the most important Agni here. Continuity of the sacrificial fire is guaranteed in this pit. Gruhapati means the presiding deity of every home. Gruhapati. The Agni is regarded as the head of the family. So it says, Agne Gruhapate Tvam Gruhapati Rasi. You should be a very good householder by the virtue of my being here. And similarly, when you are in my house, I am also a virtuous person. So I am devoid of all the blemishes. That is the mantras which we recite at Garhapatya. And the connecting section, this is the Vedi. As I said, this connects the eastern and western homakundas, and the shape of the Vedi is similar to the torso in seated position. We store all the ingredients for the nourishment of the brain and limbs in the body. Similarly, the Vedi has the respective functionality, and it is also the sign to maintain cleanliness and hygiene in the pantry section at the home. Because specifically all the mantras point about it. Every morning and evening, the Yajamana, the principal custodian of the Agni, extends the fire from Garhapatya to all the three Homakundas to conduct Agnihotra. The ingredients are very minimal, such as few spoons of milk, ghee, curd or soup. The ritual also suggests that we could increase your concentration with minimum consumption of food. Thus, the entire gamut of the ritual as well as the forms and contours required for its facilities prescribe an environment of frugality and sincerity to achieve welfare at large. And we have got few more shapes which give us a broader idea of what the rituals are about. One is called the Shyana Chiti. It says annihilation of the enemies and reaching the higher planes of heaven. This is the diagram of Shyana Chiti, and if it is 5-layered, it is called Pancha Chitika. If it is 3-layered, it is called the Trichitika. This is the diagram of Pancha Chitika Shyana Chagana Agni diagram. And this is the actual diagram. It is described in the Agni Chagana Prakarana from the 5th Kanda. It says, Purusha Matrena Vimimite Yajnana Vai Purusha Samitaha. A person, a Yajamana, if he is standing on the ground, if he extend his right arm, the length between his tip of his finger to the toe, that is called the Purusha Matra. And several measurements are given here. I will just quote them here. Purusha is the from toe to the tip of the extended hand vertically, and Aratni is the 24 angula. And angula means an inch. And Vyama is extended hands horizontally. If it is vertical, it is called the Purusha. And if it is horizontal, it is called the Vyama. And Hasta is the 5th part of Purusha. And Anguli is the 24th part of the Hasta. And Yava is the 8th part of the Anguli. And Yuka is the 8th part of the Yava. And Liksha is the 8th part of the Yuka. These are the commentarians' notes. And we have got several types of homakundas which are used in the in our agamas. One is called the vritta, circular. Abja is the lotus one. Ardhachandra is half round. Yoni is similar to the heart shape. Triyasra, triangle. Chaturasra is quadrangle. Panchasra or panchakona is pentagon. Shadasra or shatkona is hexagon. Saptasra or saptakona is heptagon. And ashtasra or ashtakona is octagon. And the dimensions are also stipulated for each requirement. Ekahasta kunda, if you are offering 1000 ahutis, you are taking the ekahasta kunda. And if it is 10,000 or lesser, it is dvihasta kunda. 1 lakh or lesser, it is trihasta kunda. And 1 million or lesser, it is chaturhasta kunda. And 1 crore or below, it is shadhasta kunda. And above 1 crore, it would be Ashtahasta Kunda. These are the measurements suggested and stipulated in the Kundarka. And I'm just giving you this thing. We also have in your memoir also here. This is the Vartula Kunda. And this is the...
Two minutes.
Yes,
time is over.
Yes. So this is the Vartula Kunda. This is the Abja Kunda, the lotus shaped. And this is the Ardhachandra Kunda. And this is the Yoni Kunda, which is usually associated with the rituals of Devi. And this is the Trikona Kunda, Chaturasra, and Shatkona Kunda, Ashtakona Kunda. So finally, the conclusion is that the mystic nature of the nature, mystic nature is intriguing enough to ignite anyone to think about the relationship between the microcosmos and the macrocosmos. That is why we call Anoho Aniyan, Mahato Mahiyan, Atma Guhajam, Nihitoskya Jantoho. The beauty of this mantra is, it says you do not need to venture out in the world to understand the relationship. Akratahu means one who does not make any attempt, physical attempt. You just see, because this is not a physical laboratory where you can do all these things. Because at cosmic level, we are very limited in our stature and our body shape and its size. So, akratahu pashkati vita shokaha. When you have the ultimate concentration in your mind, and without a physical effort, you would be able to understand the connection between the microcosmos and the macrocosmos. That is the important thing. And through this, our Vedic scriptures and the traditions teach us many things which we should practice in our lives. And most importantly, we should understand the equitable distribution to all the constituents including the creatures around us, including the animals and birds. That is the most important tenet of these Vedic inscriptions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ganapati ji. You have very rightly and elaborately talked about the Vedic sacred heritage. And in that context, you have pointed out how the very important role of geometrical forms were there, and they were having certain definite meanings, connotations, and which are in continuity. That is very important. It is not merely the past, but that comes to the present. So, excellent paper. Now, if some questions, observations are there, most welcome.
See, these 10 types of kundas that I have listed in the Kundarka, it is said to be in the 14th or 15th century. The Kundarka, the treatise was listed. Till then, we had suggested in the Agamas, because we belong to a tradition where we don't actually date any text. Yes, so it is not specifically mentioned in the Vedic texts, but in the Agamas, we have got references. And Kundarka is a collection of all these. Yes. It's, I have the PDF copy with the Sanskrit commentary. I can share it with you. Yes, very. The shapes make an important. Yes. Yes, you're right. See, actually, I wanted to explain the about each angle adds a dimension in life.
But I think in the Vedic yajna also, when we talk of the Vedis or the altars, there must have been the form.
Yes, what exactly I wanted to say was the forms are
and
given.
The forms are,
Shroni, etc., are perfectly mentioned in all the Shrota Sutras and the Kalpa Sutras. We have them.
Right.
What I said was the underlying significance of each shape was not given. That we are inferring. That's what I said.
Right. What was tradition before that? What were the traditions before that? The Kundas, Imars, something like that.
No, traditions were there. See, we believe in such a this thing. See, even before Panini was there, the grammar was of course there. He has more efficiently devised a system. Even before the Shrauta Sutras, we had all the traditions. It was codified in a better way. So that's the only thing. So even before that, we had all the systems in place. So that's why no one calls we are the originators. Because see, in none of the Vedic traditions, they say, I am the originator of this thing. Unlike any Abrahamic religion or something, none of our traditions have started with a single person. They had only better codified them or probably put them into a textual form. That's the only thing that I have done.
Definitely. Yes. You say that the Vedas did not come out of Shunya. Something must have been earlier and
We are actually proponents and believers in this philosophy that it's a continuity for eternity. It's a continuity. Even the jiva that we are talking about, it had its previous remnants in very minuscule form, in sukshma rupa. And when the time has become ripe, then we had manifested ourselves. Yes.
Yes. I would like to know the actual, for example, the bird, the chitti. Is that symbolic of something, or is it symbolic of itself? And how does the Vedic interpreter know? Is it in the Vedas themselves, or is it through a bhashya, or is it? How do you understand?
Yes, Shyera Chiti, Gurdhra Chiti, Suparna Chiti, Naka Chiti. These are some of the names that are given here. And as I said, some of the texts in the commentaries have suggested, and the Brahmana Granthas, when explaining, they said that Shkena Iva Bhutva Subargan Lokam Patati. Shkena Iva Bhutva Subargan Lokam Patati. As an eagle can fly very high and reach the top of our sight, similarly, the departed soul will be able to fly high and reach the heaven.
So it's metaphorical language. So it's a metaphorical sentence.
Yes, yes. It's symbolic of our attaining a higher stage. Attaining a higher stage in life. Shulba Sutras, actually Shulba means a rope. With a piece of rope, how to measure and how to construct. And as any engineering student is given a compass type of thing. Similarly, with a Shulba Sutra, with that you would be able to construct anything, and they had given the diagram and radius, and with the diameter and radius, how best you would be able to do this thing, and how do you construct a squares, and how do you perfectly angle them in a circle. These are very detailedly, they are given in detail in Shulba Sutras. But the shapes are given actually in the Vedic texts.
This should be the last question, please.
The example of six-sided kunda, eight-sided kunda, that is the highest, I think.
Yes.
Have you ever seen or studied about a 12-sided kunda, 27-sided kunda, or maybe 108? Because these are very sacred numbers.
See, in our traditions, we can't say why not, because we don't live on figments of imagination. Because we have a limitation that whatever is, because see, you are talking about something which is out of this world, alaukika things. Because you can't measure punya in terms of liters or kilos or something like this. It's not quantified. So what, if you perform a certain way of thing, it is believed to give you some positive result. If some rishi has said this, then only you follow. Out of your whims and fancies, if you want to do that, I can't prohibit you. But I don't say that I don't subscribe to those views. So this is the highest one that is given in the Kundarka text. That's what I can say.
Okay. Now I thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. Dr. Ganapathi ji.